Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, pursuant to the resolution of Parliament on 10 February 2017, I move that the Electricity Bill 2017 be debated, voted upon and be passed. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Do you have a seconder?
Madam Speaker, I beg to second the motion.
Now call the Honourable Attorney General to speak on his motion.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, the Electricity Bill 2017 being debated today is a result of government's intention to corporatize Fiji Electricity Authority and create a company or corporate entity that would be registered under the Companies Act, and this company would subsequently be partially divested. Under the Fiji Electricity Act, Madam Speaker, FEA is currently enjoying a position in the market for retail, transmission and distribution of electricity in Fiji. FEA also, Madam Speaker, at the same time, whilst performing these functions of generation, transmission and distribution and retailing, FEA also performs the regulatory functions of approval of licenses and compliance with safety standards. A key feature of this bill, Madam Speaker, is focused on the regulatory reform in the electricity industry in Fiji. As you know, Madam Speaker, that has similarly been done for the telecommunications industry. We now have the Telecommunications Authority of Fiji that deals with the regulatory aspects of telecommunications in Fiji. Madam Speaker, of course, given the partial divestment and the fact that it will be corporatized, it is not appropriate for the company to regulate the electricity industry or to issue electricity-related licenses. Indeed, Madam Speaker, a number of times, because FEA is the generator of electricity, the transmitter and the retailer, and at the same time it's also one that regulates itself, sometimes also consumers' rights are somehow or the other swept to the side because you're actually complaining to an organization that is fulfilling both roles. Madam Speaker, the objective of course, as we said, to establish an independent regulator to deregulate the electricity industry and further enhance the government's policy for good governance, transparency and accountability. The primary roles and responsibility of the regulator will be to, with the consent of the Minister, issue licenses in relation to generation, transmission and supply of electricity, to determine tariffs and price methodology of electricity to protect the interests of consumers, which is specifically stated in the amendment, the law itself, and the administration, enforcement and regulation of the electricity industry, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, the bill also includes consequential amendments to the Commerce Commission Act 2010 to give effect to the proposed role of the regulator to the Fiji Commerce Commission in the event of that happening, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, the bill was first tabled in Parliament on 10th of February. The bill is referred to the Standing Committee on Justice, Law and Human Rights for public consultations. The Standing Committee has heard numerous submissions from members of the public, the Consumer Council, and following the public consultations, some amendments were made to the bill, which is what we are also agreeing to, which has been tabled, Madam Speaker. These amendments have been highlighted in pink in the bill itself, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, I know there's a lot of talk, there's a lot of misinformation about the divestment. We have always said from day one that energy, electricity, is very important to a small country like Fiji, which is actually a price taker. It's not a price setter as far as fossil fuel is concerned. But of course, for a country like Fiji, we need to ensure that we have sources of energy that are non-dependent on fossil fuels, which means renewable energy. Monosagu, of course, Madam Speaker, was the first non-renewable energy infrastructure that was put up in Fiji back in the 1970s. And of course, since then, we've had Nandari Batu, we've had the raising up of the Weir, further down the track from Monosagu, and we've had the Butoni wind farm, which of course has had its own challenges. It was put up in a very strenuous circumstances, to be diplomatic about it, and there's other projects that have come on stream. We've also seen that the world has shifted, in particular given the discourse and indeed the implementation of various policies pertaining to climate change, a focus on mitigation as far as carbon footprint is concerned. Mitigation has led to the advent of new technology in the world. As you saw, our Honourable Prime Minister, for example, was in Marrakesh recently, last year, and he signed an agreement with the Indian government initiative regarding usage of solar energy. FEA has signed a MOU with the Reunion Islands, which is out in the Indian Ocean, in respect of using solar energy combining with agriculture. So a number of these initiatives, a number of new technologies have come to the fore, which of course the Fijian government must be able to take advantage of through Fiji Electricity Authority, but also to be able to bring in a number of partners that are strategic partners, to be able to not just provide the capital for that, not also at the same time to, it is also at the same time to reduce the number of government guarantees that is there put in place. Because obviously with the divestment, Madam Speaker, if we are to divest, say, 45% of our shares in FEA, we expect our guarantee portfolio to also reduce by 45%. So these are some of the positive things that will be put in place with the divestment of our shares, Madam Speaker. Again, Madam Speaker, there's also been a lot of kerfuffle about various other groups, probably with some political motivations, have not necessarily carried out an objective analysis of what actually will be precipitated by the divestment of the shares of Fiji Electricity Authority, Madam Speaker. But of course it encourages private sector participation in respect of renewable energy companies coming into the fore, supplying to the grid. The Honourable Minister for Forests earlier on spoke about the initiative regarding the pine and how this Korean company is now set up. They'll of course be supplying to the grid. A few years ago, Madam Speaker, renewable energy companies were only being offered very minimum amounts of money as cost recovery and indeed as payments for them to be able to supply to the grid. They're only being offered about 10 or 11 cents. Now, as we know, that renewable energy, it always has a much higher end input as far as capital investment is concerned. So capital investment is very high in the initial stages, but of course your source of energy is much cheaper. A lot of people shy away from capital investment in renewable energy because of the upfront cost and the commitment you need to make. Now, many of them will actually do that if they know that the return on investment will actually be steady, will be guaranteed, will not be manipulated with, and which actually will give them a good rate of return. So this is why with the changes brought about, firstly by the Bainimarama government in respect of some of the tariff changes that took place, and also ensuring that those who are the high-end users actually do pay more, the commercial users, but reduce the burden for low-income earners, ordinary Fijians. So, Madam Speaker, we also intend to, with the divestment, list FEA on the South Pacific Stock Exchange to develop the capital markets. We are also currently looking at, Madam Speaker, while not directly related to the bill, we are also looking at how we can provide a demutualized process whereby ordinary Fijians who are currently account holders of FEA, I'm talking about domestic account holders, they could be also given shares in the company. That currently is being worked out, and as to what percentage of the shares that they will get. This will also, Madam Speaker, as we have a number of what we call prepay users of electricity in Fiji. Many people, for example, at the moment, you know, they go and load it up and then they get the electricity. Those people also, Madam Speaker, at the moment, are the beneficiaries of government-subsidized scheme for electricity. As you know, that we had made an announcement that those people who earn below $30,000 a year, government will actually subsidize half of their tariff rates. So we pay at the moment, Madam Speaker, out of the 33.04 cents, we pay actually 17 cents and contribute towards the tariff. So in this way, Madam Speaker, rather than having a blanket approach to the tariff structure, it is better to have targeted assistance. Because when you have a blanket approach to tariff structure, even the rich will benefit from it. So government's funds are better utilized with targeted assistance, and this is precisely what we're going to do. This is precisely what we intend to do in respect of the demutualization of the shares. Madam Speaker, I've covered a lot of this, and of course I can come back and answer any questions that may come from the floor. But Madam Speaker, just by very quickly to highlight again, honourable members of the House, that there's a number of significant changes that of course have taken place, and the bill seeks to address them, Madam Speaker. Just to allay the fears, I know there's been a lot of talk about it, I saw some comments in the letters to the editor in the Fiji Times, where they're saying that we're selling off our assets. Madam Speaker, that is not the case. The proposal, of course, is as we've done with Fiji Ports Corporation Limited. even though we've got FNTF and 18 Spencer's shareholders in Fiji Ports Corporation Limited, all the assets have actually been transferred to a government company called Assets Fiji Limited, or AFL, for want of a better acronym, and they still reside with government. Similarly, with FEA, Madam Speaker, we have actually, as far as all the freehold properties are concerned, they'll be put into the Assets Fiji Limited asset base. But as far as all the lease properties are concerned, Madam Speaker, they will continue as they are, Madam Speaker, and the landowners, whoever it is that is receiving the benefits, will continue to receive those benefits, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, just to put into perspective in respect of some of the challenges, of course, of FEA, just to put into perspective, in 2000, Madam Speaker, FEA had 117,315 customers in 2000. Today, FEA has 174,530 customers, an increase, Madam Speaker, of about 60,000 customers within that period. Madam Speaker, I also would like to highlight the capital expenditure of FEA from 2000 to 2006 was $32 million. From 2007 to 2016, it was around $77 million, an increase of about nearly $50 million. What essentially shows you there are more connections, more homes being connected, more investments being made. So between the period of 2000 to 2006, FEA was connecting an average around 3,000 new customers. This does not make a distinction between domestic or commercial, but there were 3,000 new customers between 2000 and 2006. Today, Madam Speaker, we are connecting 5,500 new customers on a yearly basis, I'm talking about. So it has increased exponentially. There's obviously a lot of demand being put in place in FEA. Of course, Madam Speaker, the customers per employee have increased by 89%. Electricity generation output per employee has increased by 127%. The route length of power lines and underground cables per employee has increased by 77%. And asset value per employee has increased by 229%. The cash position, Madam Speaker, is obviously much better than what it was. It was making losses, and I can give those facts and figures later on if any of the members are interested in that. This also to put into perspective, Madam Speaker, in 2005, land lease monies, as in lease monies, that was paid out to landowners on an annual basis was $160,000 in 2005. In 2016, they are now paying $380,000 per annum. The royalty and generation, Madam Speaker, was paid out to landowners in Monosagu. This was done by FEA. It was paid 50 cents per megawatt hour, 50 cents. Today, they are getting paid 60 cents. From 2007, it was increased from 50 cents to 60 cents. Obviously, Madam Speaker, if the company does do well, there's a lot more opportunity. If there's less burden in terms of the cash flow, the company can be able to develop a lot more partnerships, in particular with the landowners and various other stakeholders, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, one of the major challenges of FEA is the aging assets. As you know, that recently last year and the year before last, the major trenches were dug up all the way up to the city, right up to Kinoya, because of the old cables that have not been replaced for about 50 or 60 years. They are now, of course, being replaced. But the poor cash position, Madam Speaker, in 2006 and prior to that, actually stopped them from doing so. Since the last 3 years, Madam Speaker, FEA has commenced replacement of these aging assets. We anticipate to spend more than $150 million in the next 5 to 7 years. Madam Speaker, in respect of Monosagu, there has been a huge amount of work that needs to be done. In fact, after 2010, some $50 million has been spent in refurbishing Monosagu. And we expect a lot more refurbishments to be done. As we've said numerous times, Madam Speaker, in Fiji we have always been very good at building things when we do build things, but we're not very good at looking after it. We need to go back and make sure that the asset actually maintains the same value. A lot more money needs to be set aside for the maintenance of those assets. And indeed, that's what we intend to do, and Monosagu, of course, will go through that phase too. We have in recent times, Madam Speaker, The Nandarivatu hydropower project, I know a lot of people have said to us on this side of the house, they say, oh, you've been in power since 2007, right up till now it's been 10 years. But the trials and tribulations we went through, Madam Speaker, from 2007 in particular, Madam Speaker, up to 2014, was quite horrendous. Many of the people on that side of the house were courting overseas governments to work against us. We had travel bans. Loans that were offered to us were withdrawn. Despite that, Madam Speaker, we have made enormous inroads. One such example, Madam Speaker, is the Nandarivatu hydropower project. $300 million Fijian dollars we are going to get funding from World Bank. That was withdrawn. Many people we know went and lobbied for it. Withdraw loans. ADB stopped giving us money. Despite all the withdrawal of those loans, we still went ahead with these projects. Some of them did cost a bit more money. Now they're costing a lot more less. We went ahead and built the Nandarivatu hydro dam, Madam Speaker, which now contributes about 40 megawatts, as was highlighted earlier on. All of this, Madam Speaker, had been done in that period where there's a lot of strenuous pressure on us, but we are very much focused on development. And FEA, Madam Speaker, of course, was able to go ahead with these projects with government guarantees being offered to be able to ensure that FEA goes ahead, borrows money from the market, because we recognize as a strategy that energy is critically important. In energy, Madam Speaker, the cost of the tariffs, in fact, Madam Speaker, if we were able to go through this divestment and have a focus on getting renewable energy sources, Madam Speaker, we could even very soon be able to bring down energy costs, or the cost of production of energy, in particular if it's going to come from renewable sources. Notwithstanding that, Madam Speaker, we have at the moment, for example, a new 35 megawatt diesel generated power generators were actually put in Kinoya, which is actually yet to be commissioned, but it's actually opening, which costs about $70 million, to be able to meet the demand. So there's obviously a lot of opportunity in respect of renewable energy companies to come into that space. As I've highlighted, Madam Speaker, that we have also increased the subsidies up to 95 kilowatts. Any household that earns less than $30,000 a year, we pay up to 17 cents. A unit to help those low-income earners. Schools, of course, Madam Speaker, are subsidized for the first 200 units consumed by them per month. And at the moment, Madam Speaker, some 69,000 domestic customers have enjoyed this subsidy in the past to the tune of around $3 million, Madam Speaker. And this, of course, applies to the prepaid units. Madam Speaker, FEA has won a number of awards. I do not want to go into all of that, but in the past few years. But also let me highlight, Madam Speaker, what has actually happened in the past, in particular regarding FEA assets. There's a lot of song and dance being made about that. Under one of the former chairmen who no longer resides in Fiji, I understand lives in some very classy suburb in Melbourne called Toorak, under him, Madam Speaker, we had some very expensive FEA assets that were sold off for peanuts. That head office of FEA, Madam Speaker, that FEA is headquartered in, was in 2005 sold for a mere $5.5 million VIP. Then when we came in, we said to FEA, that's your head office, that's your key infrastructure, you need to buy it back. They bought it back for $6.5 million. In Latoka, right next to Jasper High School, vast area of property was sold off. Nomoli House in Latoka, which is prime property worth a few million dollars, was sold for $500,000. Madam Speaker, the irony is this. When they sold it for $500,000, they went and rented a space in that property, same property, and invested $350,000 to upgrade the building for the new customer care office. These are the kind of shenanigans that went on. Properties right up to near Fiji Club, all were sold off. Madam Speaker, of course we all know about Butoni. Most wind farms, Madam Speaker, the benchmark is that it should actually operate 15% of the time, on average. Wind farms generally operate that way. Butoni, Madam Speaker, really makes it up to 7%. It's got two blades instead of the normal three blades. I can go into all of that, Madam Speaker, but the point of this is this. FEA now is being run in a professional manner. People are appointed on merit. People weren't appointed on merit previously. It was who you knew. There's huge asset wastage, Madam Speaker. We now are in a very good space. There's a lot of interest in respect of investing in Fiji Electricity Authority. Government, the Fijian government, will still own 51%. Let me reiterate, the Fijian government will still own 51% of FEA. The Fijian government, Madam Speaker, will still continue with the subsidy to low-income earners. This is part of the deal. And Madam Speaker, this law is critical to ensure that we give confidence to would-be participants. They would be people who want to actually invest. They range from Fijian holdings to FNPF to electricity companies from offshore and various other investment companies. So, Madam Speaker, I'll stop there so I can respond to other questions. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. The floor is open for debate. Thank you. Honourable Sierra Rondo.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I rise to make my contribution to this bill. Before I start, I'd like to state that there are a lot of petitions been received relating to this, against this this bill that didn't make its way to the committee because of the shortness of time. Madam Speaker, this bill is perhaps one of the most important ones that will come before this House because it essentially deals with critical state assets. I'll just pick out on some issues while my the rest of my colleagues can work on the other issues. I begin with the corporatization of FEA, which will enable the company to float shares through the Silver Stock Exchange, subsequently opening the way for the privatization of FEA at some future dates. For such sensitive national assets, Madam Speaker, I fear the eventual loss of this entity from the hands of the ordinary Fijian people. We've just heard about Fiji Airways this morning and the logistical arrangement that it cannot make its way in the presentation to Parliament, the annual report. I'm equally alarmed, Madam Speaker, that it seems the bill is proposing for the relevant minister to be given allowance to enter into agreements as may be required to manage the divestment transactions. Madam Speaker, who is going to provide transparent oversight over this process? And will the general public be given an opportunity to have the final say over who becomes part owner or eventual owner of FEA when its shares have been bought? Madam Speaker, what will happen to the government guarantee? Madam Speaker, in my previous budget address in 2015 and last year, I had highlighted the fact that government revenues were featuring the sale of government assets, including the divestment of FEA shares. My concerns then were on the imbalance of the budget books and the sale failed to materialize in the 2 years it appeared to be on sale. I had also highlighted the importance of separating the operations and the regulatory functions of power supply. I had in fact suggested that the FEA be left alone to carry out its mandated operational role in providing Fiji with energy supply and to leave the task of regulating the energy sector to government or even an independent regulator. This is crucial because it allows government to provide oversight of the FEA without the threat of influencing the operations with political policies as was done in 2008 and again in 2014 when the consumer rural electrification contribution was reduced from 10% to 5% and again consumers below 30,000 salary brackets were given subsidies by government. In fact, Madam Speaker, FEA revised the electricity tariff, I think in 2010 or 2013. The Minister can confirm that to us. We can argue till the cows come home, Madam Speaker, that consumers are benefiting from the reductions. But if you are to look at the issue in the long term, selling of shares of FEA in stock exchange is not only a display of desperate government measures, but also reflects government's inability to safeguard the national crucial assets, which can be vulnerable for manipulation, ultimately costing consumers more in bills to pay when the new co-owners of FEA begin to demand maximum returns on their investment. In fact, I had a petition here requesting, Madam Speaker, if the government had a privatization consultation report to be also tabled in this Honourable House. Madam Speaker, whoever decides to buy in these shares will be expecting to make profit and not simply engage in a community service. So whilst consumers have been assisted and made happy for elections and a rosy picture is painted of a government image, subsequently this nation will be under a threat of escalating living costs, Madam Speaker, made worse by the Reserve Bank's forecast of 6.8% inflation cost revealed about 3 weeks ago to our ears. Let me end, Madam Speaker, by suggesting that government looks within Fiji's domestic market if it is really serious about divesting FESAs. By doing that, they maintain these crucial assets within our nation, and the assistance of consumer councils, to name a few, we can control the cost of our bills. I ask government to look at the resource owners as partners for the business entrepreneurship, for example. Those in Naita City and assist them become co-owners of FEA. They've been asking the Honorable Prime Minister for this. In fact, on a number of occasions when he had visited the province, because they know they can benefit more than just earning lease money on a commodity which has been derived through the use of their natural resources. Perhaps, Madam Speaker, the Naita City province shares in Fijian Holdings could be used to purchase these shares in FEA. And similarly, other provinces could be encouraged to partner the Naita City province in this regard. For me, Madam Speaker, that would be a more beneficial investment for our FHL shares, instead of government just deciding to sell off or buy entities using our FHL shares without our province's consent. On that note, Madam Speaker, and my contribution and register my reservation objections to this bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. When you when one is looking at partial divestment, Madam Speaker, there are always advantages and disadvantages of doing that. And if you look at how this is done, the experiences of partial divestment, corporatization leading to partial divestment, it's always the timing and it's always the objective. Madam Speaker, I am not sure that, and perhaps the Honorable Attorney General in some ways putting out the figures and the progress that FEA has made with respect to its financial performance. And indeed, you know, I agree with him. In fact, you know, I tend to say that the wisdom of appointing, Madam Speaker, some very smart business people on some of the boards to run commercial entities such as FEA and others makes sense. And I think FEA right now is probably in a much stronger position than what it was before. And that itself, Madam Speaker, suggests that it's probably not a good idea for government to think about partial divestment now. The other reason why I think the timing is perhaps not right, I mean, Fiji's presidency of COP23 and the commitments that we're going to make in terms of moving ourselves towards renewable energy, more renewable energy in the future, itself makes a case that perhaps, you know, FEA should remain fully in the hands of the government so that we can make this transition. And Madam Speaker, I want to quote the figures again. I mean, we still need 112 megawatts of diesel capacity, and we just told in the morning that we'll probably have another 14.5 megawatts of power from the biomass production that the minister referred to earlier. So, in some ways, the task of the FEA right now is to ensure that we have continued energy security, that we continue to make the investments. And the Attorney General, Honorable Attorney General himself pointed out the investment that needs to be made in the Monosabu Hydro Scheme. And I think he's right, because that 80 megawatt capacity, Madam Speaker, is no longer there. It's less than 80 megawatts. So in some sense, the best thing for government to do now is to not go into partial divestment now. And the FEA grid can be fed by independent power producers. And, you know, if, for example, Madam Speaker, if you have an investor A, B, or C, the government can provide incentives, other kinds of incentives for those power producers to feed into the FEA grid and contribute to the overall energy supply. So, Madam Speaker, I think it doesn't make sense I know the budget had a provision in 2015 and 2016, and then 2016-17 as well, for partial divestment of FEA. I don't want to assume that this is being done to sort out the budget. I hope it is not, because the important thing, Madam Speaker, is that we are making a transition, an important transition, not only in terms of the demand for energy. More and more people, if you look at the objective of government and what we want as legislators, we want to provide as much, as many people as possible with power. So the demand is going to rise as we move into the future. And that is why it is absolutely vital that the government keeps a handle on FEA for a much longer period than divesting the partial or the partial divestment at the moment. Madam Speaker, those the more general point. In fact, would have been very good if we had more time, because this is such an important bill. You know, we are making such an important decision, and it's rather unfortunate that we don't have the time. And I have many issues with respect to each of the clauses, and I do not want to go through all of them, because I want to leave some time for my colleagues to make the contribution as well. But Madam Speaker, the government could still keep FEA 100% shares, have an independent regulator, provide incentives to independent power suppliers, and all of them can feed into the FEA grid, and the incentives can be used, because FEA seems to be doing well and has been investing in the infrastructure. So it is not, to me, it doesn't make sense right now to go the way that we are trying to go through this bill. Madam Speaker, as I said, and I want to repeat this, because this is very important. For important bills such as this, Madam Speaker, we need a lot of time. People need to speak on this, you know, raise their issues, because the people of this country want to hear. In the end, they make up their mind whether the government is doing the right thing or not, but at least we should be given the opportunity in this House to have a thorough debate on each aspect of the bill. And I would have, if I had time, Madam Speaker, I would have gone through each of the clauses and made my comments and suggestions. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, at the outset, Madam Speaker, we don't think we should sell 49% of FEA. The organization is doing very well, has got a very strong balance sheet, with net assets of about $700 million and assets of about $2 billion. It's doing well. It's serving the people of Fiji very well. And there really is no call to go this way unless there's a need to raise some funds immediately. We had 2 years ago, Madam Speaker, in this House, when we learned about the plan by government to divest or to sell off some states' enterprises, Ratu Nengam and I had put together a motion to say that let that be done locally. And we mentioned that maybe Fijian Holdings should be the lead company to bring together a conglomerate of companies to buy these local companies, for the reason that A, to keep it local, and B, Fijian Holdings being belonging to the Itokei would help pay back to the Itokei what they have given to Fiji in terms of freeing up their resources for developments of where we are today. Now, Madam Speaker, when I look at Section 30 I come across the State Acquisition of Land Act 1940. It takes me back to the beginning of Fiji, that in 1940 they passed this act to enable government to acquire land or resources for the development of this country. And to me, that history is very similar to the history of FEA. It has grown today to be a $2 billion company. And to treat it in this manner, to use this standing order 51 to have 1 hour debate to put finality to diversify it, it's quite sad. It deserves better than that. Our people should have had the opportunity to contribute to this bill, but it's very, very radical. And you know, you ask the question, is Fiji ready to privatize something this huge? It is sometimes privatization is part privatization. It's going to be on a stock exchange. It's going to be like Fiji Airways. Sometimes a developing country needs to take it slowly. We should, you know, Australia and New Zealand sold off their companies, the enterprises, after 100 years. Here we are rushing into this, a nation that is still very, very young, and getting ourselves into this kind of situation. And Madam Speaker, if I can go back to what my colleague, Honorable Sir Andondo, has said, the resource owners of Netasiri should have a share in this. Yes. It's a way of saying thank you to them for all these years that we use their resources to bring electricity across the country. The other side has often spoke of Monosabu, of how they were neglected, but forgetting that the chiefs of Fiji agreed with the people of Netasiri to generate electricity in there and bring it to the urban centers for the majority of the people in this country. That is something that we need to remember. The generosity needs to be appreciated and needs to be factored into the new formula for the economic development of those people. This is not unique to Fiji. In Malaysia, for the Bumiputras, any state enterprise that is privatized, the first opportunity is given to the Bumiputras, or even they're even given the funding by government for them to buy shares. I believe, Madam Speaker, the way we should go forward is 51% of the government of Fiji, 30% of the people in Netasiri, and 19% whoever you want to give it to. That, Madam Speaker, is the way forward. It's a way of repaying the generosity of the people who have been giving their resources since 1940. And I live in a country where electricity shortages is not a way of life. There are countries in the world where it's every day, 2 or 3 hours a day, you don't have electricity. In Fiji, we don't have that. It's because people have been generous, giving the resources which we enjoy today. So it's time at this juncture to recognize the generosity and give back to the resource owners something to say thank you, yes. And you are part of the economic progress of this country. Thank you. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
There's only 2 more minutes. I will give it to government and the Honorable Fijian. You have 2 minutes.
Only 2 minutes, ma'am.
2 more minutes.
I support the bill.
Madam Speaker, just 2 more minutes. I'll take 1 minute for somebody to respond to Honorable Gavoka. It's amazing how they're so selective in their approach with what they say. What about those people in Somsomo that provided us with the land for the electricity? What about somebody who may establish the hydro plant in Namosi? What about those? When we do things, we look at it collectively for people right around the country. We're not selective. Thank you very much. Madam Speaker, there are a couple of benefits that I really need to raise. Except there's a benefit in having an independent regulator with respect to the FEA, and having an independent regulator, which is part of the bill, assists in the overcoming the problem of flow of information between the regulated industry, that is FEA, and its regulator. In FEA's, in Fiji's case, FEA under the current act has the role of regulator for approval of licenses and compliance with safety standards. Madam Speaker, the bill provides that the minister or the regulator has a duty to protect the interests of the consumers, and this is in respect of section 6.3. This is to do with electricity prices charged, continuity of supply, and quality of electricity supply. Madam Speaker, just a quick thing that probably is quite important with respect to business development and the cost of doing business. Madam Speaker, the bill will lead to a conducive environment for business and investments, independence of the regulation of the electricity industry, and instills confidence in investors. You know, with the separation of functions proposed under the bill, the FEA focuses on generation, supply, and transmission. It will improve their efficiency, and the bill will enable competitors to enter the market on certain terms and conditions, and I think that's relative in Section 6.1. It will provide an equal opportunity, Madam Speaker, to the private sector to participate in the production and supply of electricity. This will facilitate competition and improve efficiency and provide new and improved techniques for the supply of electricity. And since we have an independent regulator, it will implement that the law, the actions are taken within the framework. The business community looks for a constant set of regulations and guidelines upon which the investment decisions depend for their viability. Therefore, the electricity bill, Madam Speaker, 2017 will not... Paper?
Honourable...
Thank you, Madam Speaker. With those, we support the bill.
Are you willing to give you a few minutes?
No.
Thank you, Honourable Minister.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. With those few thoughts, we support the bill.
Honourable Chair, do you have to speak in reply?
No.
I now give the floor to the Honourable Attorney General to give his right of reply.
Madam Speaker, Fiji did not commence in 1940 or 1942. That was not the beginning of Fiji. Madam Speaker, I would like to very quickly say that again, like yesterday and again like this morning, whenever the opposition talk about such matters, they again demonstrate their lack of knowledge regarding finance, regarding commercial arrangements, regarding how companies work, regarding the economy. You know, there's a suggestion by that side. Pick 30%, give it to this group of people, pick 20%, give it to that people. Are they going to guarantee the $700 million loans? Where will they get money to guarantee the $700 million loans? We just pick up shares and give it away? Is that how it works? It does not work that way. Madam Speaker, they said that the listing on the Southbank Stock Exchange is a sign of desperation. Of course not. Fijian Holdings is listed in Southbank Stock Exchange. Is it desperate? When they set up Fijian Holdings, was it desperate? When those people who enjoy Class A, Class B shares, in particular Class A shares, were they desperate? Or was it a windfall for them? SVT government listed ATH. Were they desperate? Yes, they were at that time, I think. That's the only time they got to balance their books. Were they desperate? Madam Speaker, this is the level of contradiction that's coming from the other side. Madam Speaker, they talk about inflation. They say our inflation has gone up 6%. Anybody who knows about economics knows that after a cyclone, inflation does increase. Kava in the Western Division, last weekend our store was being sold for $120 a kilo. Kava contributes 2.5% to the basket of goods that we use to measure CPI. Consumer Price Index, if you don't know what that means. Madam Speaker, CPI. It has a huge bearing to... Listen, please. 2.5% towards the basket, Madam Speaker. Obviously, Madam Speaker, if it's going to increase to $120, it's going to have a huge impact. Fruits and vegetables, Madam Speaker. Fruits and vegetables did. I will present, Madam Speaker, facts and figures to this Parliament regarding that. Madam Speaker, the other point is this. They say that if Fijian Holdings is going to buy shares in FEA, why are they not consulting the shareholders? When Fijian Holdings goes and forms a joint venture with Vinod Patel, they go and form a joint venture with a New Zealand company. When they buy shares in RB Patel, when they buy shares everywhere else, do they go and consult the shareholders? Of course not. That's not how companies run. A company has a board. The board has management. They make decisions. And that's how they make decisions. Suddenly, they want them to go to the shareholders just for FEA. This, Madam Speaker, again demonstrates they don't understand how companies are run. And this is why the contribution is quite minimalist towards this particular debate. Madam Speaker, the other thing is also is that they have talked about how in 2014 we had listed to sell. Yes, we had. 2015 we had listed to sell. Yes, we had. Madam Speaker, what that demonstrates to them, if we were desperate, we would have simply sold it off if we just wanted the money. We want strategic partners. We want the right valuation. We want the right people to come into FEA. Therefore, the whole purpose of this is to be strategic. Completely agree with Honorable Prasad that the demand for electricity will grow. This is why any good government thinks ahead. We don't think up till our noses. We have to strategically place ourselves to know which is the best way to deal with that demand. We all talk about Singapore. The Singaporean leadership thought 20 years down the track. It's like the same example that I've used. The airstrip that they built in Lambasa many years ago, in Wailevu, they built it between the bend of one river. So you can't extend it. They did not think that aircraft will get bigger than 12-seater planes. Today, a full load of 72 ATR cannot take off full load. But if they had thought and used their vision and thought ahead, they would have selected an area where you could extend the runway easily. Today we can't. This, we are paying, this is the legacy cost of what we are doing. Same thing with Sabu, Madam Speaker. So in the same way, we are today strategically placing ourselves without compromising our national strategy by able to invite investors, local and foreign, to be able to ensure that FEA moves up to the next step ahead. As we have seen previously, Madam Speaker, a utility company like FEA can get affected by world market prices. An airline does get affected by world market prices. Your profit levels 1 year may be good, but if the price of fuel goes up exponentially, that can be wiped off overnight. We've seen that happen. So these are assets that are vulnerable, their operating costs are vulnerable to circumstances beyond our control. This is why we need to be able to position ourselves a lot better. This is why we need to think ahead. They're only saying, oh, you made $69 million, that's good, you don't need to do anything. Let's sit on that. And then we run as soon as we have problems. We don't want that situation, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, I can give numerous examples. We had the SVT government selling the Fiji Ship and Heavy Industries company to a $2 New Zealand company. Then they bought it back at a much higher price. There are numerous examples of what happened, Madam Speaker. We are not doing that. We are actually positioning ourselves. And they say it took Australia and New Zealand 100 years to go into private divestment. Does that mean that Australia and New Zealand did that, then we have to wait for 100 years? Australia and New Zealand, the indigenous people were raped and pillaged, the land was taken away, terra nullius was declared. Does that mean we go down that path too? Of course not. We want to leapfrog into modality. We need to leapfrog into positioning ourselves a lot better. We don't have to follow a linear pattern of development. That's what they're saying. Let's follow a linear pattern of development. Because somebody else took 100 years to do it, let's do it. That's ridiculous, Madam Speaker. I've still got 20 minutes. Madam Speaker, the fact of the matter is this, that the intention of government at the end of the day is to ensure that ordinary Fijians who are at the lower end of the socioeconomic scale need to be looked after. The government has already declared its interest in respect of providing subsidies directly to them. We provide assistance to schools. Madam Speaker, the fact of the matter is, a person who has a swimming pool in their house, has a number of lights, has a number of facilities, they should not pay the same rate as a person who simply has a television set and a TV. If you want to have more appliances, if you want to live the high life, you pay for it. That's a user pay system. But if you are at the low end of socioeconomic scale, the government will look after you. Well, in fact, I should say, the Fiji First government will look after you. The Fiji First government will look after you because we have a focused attention. We have a focused attention of those people at the lower end of socioeconomic scale, Madam Speaker. So, Madam Speaker, we want to tell the people of Fiji who are watching and listening that this divestment is actually good for us. It is a good investment. It is a strategic move. It will not affect your rights as a consumer of Fiji. It will not affect you if you are at the lower end of the socioeconomic scale. This government will step in and provide you assistance, just as we've done with education, just as we've done with water and various other areas. It's targeted assistance. But that targeted assistance, Madam Speaker, should not deter us from inviting other investors into Fiji, from allowing companies like Fijian Holdings, like our investments, our banks, our investing life insurance companies, other local private investors becoming partners with other people who have a lot more professional skill sets. That's what it's all about. Fijian Holdings never ran a supermarket. They never went and sold any flour or anything. But they went and partnered with R.B. Patel. And today, that is making them lots of money. It's very simple. In the same way, Fijian Holdings can partner with an energy company from overseas. They can partner with FNPF. And they can make more money. At the end of the day, Madam Speaker, it's not about who we're going to put up there. It's about putting the right people there, because the company's main objective, Madam Speaker, is not to appoint a good set of people who look good, who you may have cocktails together. Your idea is to appoint people who will provide a return to the shareholders. Ultimately, that's what matters. The shareholders matter. The shareholders for Fijian Holdings, Madam Speaker, are the provinces, are the people living in the provinces. If you go and tell them, oh, we've appointed these people, maybe one ethnic group, or maybe we all know them, and they all go great, but next year when they don't have the returns and the profits, they're the same people who say, why did you appoint them? We have to appoint the right people, so they will make the right strategic decisions, and then the shareholders will benefit. At the end of the day, that's what matters. In the same way, they have acknowledged that in some of the boards, we have changed board membership. We put the right people there. Guess what's happening? Those state-owned enterprises that weren't doing well before, they're now getting decisions that are made well. Decisions made by people who actually have some experience. Decisions made by people who have some technical, commercial competency levels. That did not happen before, Madam Speaker. So we have kind of digressed with the responses that they have given into a completely different new area, but I have to clarify that, Madam Speaker. Again, Madam Speaker, I think we've addressed all the points that they have raised, Madam Speaker. We have a good set of professional staff. FEA is one of the very few companies in Fiji that has a very high level of Fijian employees. Very high level. We like to maintain it that way. Very few expatriates, if any. Madam Speaker, I was just looking for somebody who could give me some indication what are the one or two numbers. Generally, Madam Speaker, it's a good run company. We need to be able to get it to tie up with good professional investors so we can take it up to the next level. And we're building capacity. People are being appointed on merit. The right decisions are being made. We're being quite strategic about it. So at the end of the day, Madam Speaker, government's undertaking has been that we will, as we have seen, for example, in Fiji Ports Corporation Limited. Fiji Ports Corporation Limited, Madam Speaker, when we had the new investors come in, the turnaround time at Fiji ports increased by 33%. In other words, the ships at Suva port had to wait, could turn around within 33% times more quicker. The cost, they used to charge an additional levy on each container that came to Suva, because the turnaround times at Suva port was not good. So the shipping company said, you make us wait, we have to burn our fuel, we're going to charge you a levy on each container. Today that levy is gone. That levy is no longer applicable. So Suva port becomes more attractive for shipping companies. It becomes more attractive for shipping companies to say, look, you guys are efficient, why don't we send the container that we wanted to send to Samoa, let's put it in Fiji, become a transshipment hub, and you can take it from here. That's the strategic difference. It creates more employment. A lot more people. They're getting more bonuses. Two lots of bonuses being paid twice in a year. If you go and talk to those dock workers, they will tell you how happy they are. No jobs have been lost. In fact, jobs have been increased. They're now getting bonuses. This is the strategic thinking. Yes, Aitken Spencer is a foreign company. Yes, FNPF has invested in it. Yes, the Fijian government still owns 41%. But look at the overall impact on the economy. So, Madam Speaker, it is with that purpose that this partial divestment of 49%, of which a certain percentage will be given to ordinary consumers in Fiji. And that will also include, Madam Speaker, the landowners from Nandarivatu, from Monosavu, who for decades used to see the electricity wire. That's how they paid them back, the Alliance government and the SVT government and the SDL government. That's how they paid them back for the generosity. They said, we'll put the electricity wires over your villages, but you won't get the electricity. That's how they paid them back. The Bainimarama government, under this Prime Minister, gave them the electricity. That's the generosity. That's how we paid them back. You do pay that back with practical matters, not making grand statements about shareholdings of which you do not know about, or do not understand about, or do not know how it will be implemented. So, Madam Speaker, the reality is this. Sorry? You have pointed to, all you guys point all the time. I'm not pointing at you individually. I'm pointing the general direction. There you go. That's what we do. Madam Speaker, this is how we speak. I've already done that. I don't know why I suddenly find it offensive. Maybe because I'm talking the facts. I'm not pointing at him indirectly. Madam Speaker, the reality is this, that this bill provides an opportunity, a fantastic opportunity, for investors to come into Fiji, for us to be able to lift up the standards of Fiji Electricity Authority, and ultimately for the consumers of Fiji to benefit from a very strategic decision. With those few words, Madam Speaker, I submit that we support this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Parliament will now vote. And the question is, pursuant to the resolution of Parliament on 10 February 2017, that the Electricity Bill 2017 be debated, voted upon, and be passed. Does any member oppose the motion?
Yes.
Being opposition, Parliament will now vote. Open the vote. Close the vote.
Result of the vote as follows: 29 ayes, 15 noes, and 6 have not voted.
Thank you. There being 29 ayes and 15 noes, and 6 not voted, the motion is agreed to. Secretary.
A bill for an act to promote the development of the electricity industry by the appointment of an independent regulator to license the generation, transmission, and supply of electricity and for related matters, Bill No. 7 of 2017, enacted by the Parliament of the Republic of Fiji.